We grow.
Eddie Crow is not here, and I don't think I look like Eddie Crow. I'm Tom Young, and I'm here today as a guest fill-in for Eddie, who over the years has become a very, very good friend and somebody that I really enjoy spending time with here every month. And so it's interesting. Okay, can't go live video. Guess we'll have to wait on that. But anyway, going to be an interesting show today. I'm going to be here for 3 hours, so I sort of cut that into six segments. And this first 30 minutes that we're here today, I'm going to talk about what I'm going to talk about for the next 2.5 or 3 hours beyond that. I have a couple of guests that I expect to call in today, and one of them is the Honorable Bob McEwen, who is a former legislator from Ohio, was a congressman for a number of years. He is now the executive director of a think tank, CNP, and we'll get into that. I also have another guest, Kim Butler. Kim Butler is a unique person. I have known her for probably 30 years. I've known her husband probably a little bit longer than that. She is the author of several books. We'll talk about those when she gets on here. But she is the one that has busted all the lies and taught me a lot about the way I think and what I do. And busting the lies about everything, busting the lies about retirement, busting the lies about saving money and budget. She has a new book called Busting the Lies About Budgeting. And we were just sitting here talking with Ryan, who's kind enough to run the board for me today, because I'm not into that at this point in time. But it's interesting that busting the lies is really about developing. Now, our husband is a computer programmer and has a software program called Truth Concepts. Now, you can access this software and actually run it for 10 days free, and it will answer just about any kind of financial question, message that you want to have answered, and on and on and on beyond that. But her husband is Todd Langford, and I've known Todd for 35 years, and he wrote an original software with a program that I actually was involved in. I taught it naturally, called Leap. It is still out there today, and it is probably one of the best educational tools that I've ever had access to in what we're doing. Now, I have a habit in all the shows that I do. I always start with a prayer. So we offer our prayers for everybody around the world. This COVID virus that has gone around, it has touched every human being on the planet, I believe. It did come out of the Wuhan lab in China that is operated by the CCP. So we're going to talk about a little bit of that maybe later on in doing that. But people have had their health impaired. People have lost loved ones. So our prayers go out for those to heal their bodies. We pray for those who have lost loved ones and the loved ones who have been lost, that the Lord would gather them into his arms and take them to his kingdom of heaven above. We offer our prayers for those in Ukraine and Russia, that somehow these men would come and find the road to peace in some way and stop the destruction and the killing. Now our prayers go out for Israel and what has transpired there, that somehow there would be some kind of resolution to what is going on. In Jesus' name, we pray. Thank you for that. Anyway, as I sit here, let me talk about some of the things we're going to talk about today. So the first half hour, it's going to be, you're going to get me. And I'm going to go over some of the activities. I've got the congressman, former congressman coming, Kim Butler's coming. And then after that, we're going to get real negative. And then we're going to get real, real positive in the last half hour. Because we're going to talk about all the things that the financial world has told you, advised you, do this, do that. And I have one little story that I talk about all the time, and it's called I'll call it the 100-person story. It was originally the 100-man story But basically, the Ivy League colleges did a study of 125-year-olds starting out in life, coming out of college. And if you remember in your life, I don't know what age you are today, but if you're younger, you still, I believe and hope, you still have some hopes and dreams in your mind, things that you're thinking about and how you can get there, et cetera. And we're going to talk about that in the 11 o'clock segment to 11:30 to 12 o'clock. We're going to talk about that, how to make those dreams and goals come true in where we're going. But these activities that we have been advised to do. Now, I have all these initials after my name, COU, CHFC, RICP, RSA, and CSA. So these are educational courses that I have taken, professional courses over my 48-year, and next month it'll be 49 years I've been involved in the financial services business. We're sitting here and we're taking in all this advice. So the Ivy League colleges followed this 100 young people throughout their life and went back to interview them at age 65. And the distressing answer at age 65 is that one was rich, four were well off and doing pretty good, five were still working because they couldn't afford to stop, 36 have died, and that's mortality. 54 of them were dependent on other means. They could not make it on their own. So the system that we have followed for decades now, has led us to the point where we still, and this story, I heard it 45 years ago, 48 years ago, when I started in the financial services business. Isn't it interesting that today we still have those same results? 95% of the people end up dead or dead broke. And we're going to talk today about why is that. We're going to talk about the elements of the government, the Federal Reserve and the IRS, and where these things came into being at, why they were created, and what I believe, to my opinion, Tom's 30,000-foot view opinion of what their goal and their purpose is today. So before we get there, we're going to take a break. And we'll come back, and we're going to get into this thing. So God bless you, and we'll be back in a moment.
Stop by your local McDonald's today and pick up everyone's favorites, the Shamrock Shake and Oreo Shamrock McFlurry, now available through March 24th. Don't miss out on these fan favorites. Shamrock Shake and Oreo Shamrock McFlurry, now at McDonald's.
Here's the Beaver County forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM. Along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at BeaverCountyRadio.com.
A chilly start to the morning, otherwise partly sunny with a high near 50. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
Love is in the air, and Valentine's Day is just around the corner. Why fight the crowds by going out to dinner? Cook dinner at home and let the East Rochester and Tuska Shop and Save be your one-stop shop for you to spoil your Valentine. For starters, at the East Rochester and Tuska Shop and Save, you can get your sweetheart flowers for the table and beer or wine to sip on as you wait for the main course. They have surf and turf, as well as a variety of steaks, seafoods, and chicken, along with everything else that you need for that special meal. The bakery at East Rochester and Tuska Shop and Save has treats as sweet as your sweetheart, like heart-shaped mini cupcakes and chocolate chip cookies. They also have Valentine-themed cakes, cupcakes, and pastries of multiple varieties. Finish that up with that perfect greeting card, and you will be set for the perfect romantic evening at home. While at East Rochester Shop and Save, take a look at the True Value Hardware. They have everything you need for your next project. That's the East Rochester and Tuska Shop and Saves.
If you're a parent that's already watched plenty of youth baseball or soccer games, you know the value of teamwork. Whether it's the team on the field or your team of family members at home, strengthening that group can pay off in many ways. Keystone Wellness Programs is offering their free Strengthening Families program in Beaver County for families of children ages 10 to 14. Learn how to increase family bonding and communications, all while having fun together. Visit KeystoneWellnessPrograms.org for details.
It started with a road trip into the American Midwest. Huntington Bankers with one mission, to understand how people made sense of money. And that's how we met Dontell.
How do we control cash flow?
Calendar. Dates marked for invoices, when payroll hits.
It's messy, but it gives us a sense of what's coming.
And that's how we came up with a tool that helps businesses forecast cash flow digitally. Our customers give us the best ideas. Huntington, welcome. Member FDIC. Learn more at Huntington.com.
Hey, we're back. And we're going to continue the conversation, you know, about things that we think about in the future. And we were talking about the advice that we get. You know, we have people out there that are stockbrokers, financial planners, financial everything. You know, there are so many different titles that are used in the financial marketplace. And believe me, in no way am I saying that these people are bad people in any way, shape, or form. They're just educated by the system. Now, how did we get to where we are today, and why does it seem so dire? Well, one of the things I found in the last book that I wrote, The Family Money Farm, The CFO Project, we'll talk about that a little bit today, because if you're listening, and I'm going to give you my email, which is firedupt, F-I-R-E-D-U-P-T. That's F-I-R-E-D-U-P, firedup with a T at the end of that, at comcast.net. If you send me an email and just give me a survey, tell me what you like about my show, if you've listened to my monthly show, what I'm doing here today, what kind of topics that you would like me to talk about, and give me a mailing address, and I will mail you an autographed copy of my new book, The Family Money Farm, The CFO Project. So there's something free for you today, and we're going to do that. But in my research for this last book, I found the Fabian Society, and I want to talk about that a little bit today, because I think I cringe. You know, I'm a 74-year-old kid. I'll be 75 in September, and I feel blessed. I am so blessed by the Lord, because I don't feel 74. I just, you know, actually probably felt worse when I was 38 years old, because I weighed 285 pounds. I smoked two packs of cigarettes a day and had the hourglass of time with a big screwdriver in it, trying to make it go faster and faster. And then our little girl come into our life, and I have one daughter, and when she come, it was, we have been married almost 15 years when she got pregnant and brought our little girl into life. And she was truly a gift from God at that time in our lives. But when she came, that gave me the want or the desire. I actually quit smoking. I was going to quit by her birth, but that didn't work. But luckily, fortunately, at her first birthday, I was done. And it's been a journey since then, and I've had no desire to go back. About 3 or 4 weeks after I quit smoking, I had just a quick story. I had a gentleman named Dutch Bloom, and I don't know if any of you remember him. It was Dutch Bloom Trucking. He was one of my clients in Darlington, and I would go visit him. I lived out in that area, so when I went to his office, it was always 8 o'clock in the morning that I would show up, and he and I became friends, and we'd sit and BS in the morning and in his office. So this one morning, it's been like 3-4 weeks since I quit smoking. And I show up at his office, and we're sitting there, and I looked at him, but I said, "Hey, Dutch, guess what?" And he looked at me, and he looked at me, and it was like forever. And then he finally says, "You quit smoking, didn't you?" I says, "How did you know that? Did you talk to my wife?" He says, no. He says, "Don't take offense." He says, "You don't smell bad today." He says, "My wife and I, Bubbles and I, would think in the morning when you would come, we'd think you probably didn't sleep last night. You smoked cigarettes all night long in a little room because you smelled bad." And please don't take offense. I know what it was like to be hooked on those things and how hard it is to actually quit. But you have to wanna. You know, it isn't because everybody else wants you to quit. You have to quit because you want to quit. But that little story, and all of a sudden my mind, my thinking changed, and all I did was anytime I was around people, I literally paid attention and I could tell a smoker from 20 yards away. And all of a sudden, I could smell things that I didn't know existed. You know, just good and bad. There were some bad smells, but when you smoke, you have no real control over that. And as we talk about this planning idea in our mind, we have to think of all of the things that can happen to us. And when I work with people, I draw two lines on a piece of paper. You know, like if you're looking in your cupboard, you have a high shelf bar for high things, and then you have a middle shelf for low things. And just think of those two bars as two lines on a piece of paper. And the top one, I'll title that line protection. And when we look at protection, we think of liability, disability protection, and ultimately, unfortunately, we all get to die at least once in a lifetime. And of that, it's about the amount of coverage, the type, and the positioning of it. How does it fit into our financial picture? And on the bottom line is wealth accumulation. And we have to realize that on that wealth accumulation line down the road, I put in there the word capital accumulation, because you have to have access to capital. And I meet so many people that are just in the 401k. They're putting all they can into their 401k. They're putting in $15,000, $20,000 a year into their 401k, and they really don't have any other savings whatsoever. Well, how easy is it to get to the money that you are accumulating in that 401k? When you made that first contribution of $15,000, did it immediately turn into $1 million? No. If you understand the exponential curve, now this is mathematical, money compounding at interest is an exponential curve. The longer out, the greater and the faster it starts to grow. But while that's going on, what are the things that can happen along the way? You know, if you were sitting in my office, I would be asking you, well, what can happen in your life that would stop you from getting ahead? For you achieving this goal of being well off someday. Remember the four. One was rich. Four were well off. If I could just make the well off level, I'll be happy with that. What about job loss? Have you ever lost your job during your lifetime and have to go find another job? How about disability? You know, you have a 12 times greater percentage chance of disability than you do in dying. Something to think about. Lawsuits. You know, lawsuits are crazy today. We all of a sudden have ambulance-chasing attorneys running ads every day on the newspaper. You know, call us. You know, we'll get you more money. Divorce. 51% of the people that are married end up in divorce. Death, health problems, all of a sudden health problems prevent you from working or having a better job and more pay. What about market crashes? We'll talk about some of those today. And when I tell you my story that led to 2008, I hope and pray that you'll start to see the picture, because that's my goal today. My goal today is to help you have a vision, be able to see the possibilities in your future. Because if you're not seeing possibilities, it's your own blindness. It's not anybody else's. Nobody's holding you down. We do live in the freest country in the world with all the political turmoil and everything going on. Nothing is going to change that in any way, shape, or form. So that's what it is. So think of these things that I talked about: job loss, disability, lawsuit, divorce, death, health problems, market drop. How many of those have to go bad for you to not make it? Just one. I'm going to talk today. I'm going to give you the secret answer to how to protect against all those things. And I think I'm looking at Ryan, and we're at 29:29, and we're going to go to the news. We'll be back, and we'll get into some of this stuff on the next segment.
Life, liberty, and the pursuit of low prices at AK Nahas. This President's Day, get a Whirlpool washer with removable agitator for $4.99 or a GE French door refrigerator for only $12.99. Save up to $400 on KitchenAid stainless steel dishwasher with a third rack, only $7.49. Or a GE stainless steel print resist dishwasher for $6.29. Plus free local delivery, setup, and removal. Save more this President's Day only at AK Nahas Appliance, Furniture, Mattress, and TV. You'll do okay with AK.
Do you wish that you had the support of a family in your financial institution? You can when you become a family member at Friendly Federal Credit Union. This is Cindy Haladio. During February, the month of showing love and appreciation, Friendly Federal Credit Union wants to show you how true it really is. If you haven't already, apply for membership at Friendly Federal Credit Union with offices in Elequip and Baden. Enjoy low or no fees with your account, favorable terms and interest rates, and the added benefit of putting money back into your community. What are you waiting for? It's time for a family reunion. Join the thousands of other local people who are already part of the friendliest family in Beaver County. The member owners at the place that makes more sense for you. Friendly Federal Credit Union. Member NCUA Equal Housing Lender.
Friendly Federal Credit Union.
Tune in to Beaver County Radio every Tuesday from 4 to 6 p.m. for the Sports Corner with Ralph Williams and Smokin' Jim Frazier. The Sports Corner talks about everything that is currently going on in the sports world. Ralph and Smokin' Jim will also have special guests every week, and they'll take your calls. The show will also be streamed live on the Beaver County Radio Facebook page and YouTube channel. So make plans every Tuesday at 4 p.m. to tune in to the Sports Corner right here on Beaver County Radio.
Beaver County Radio's news source, 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
Good morning. On this Monday, February 12th, 2024, the Beaver County weather forecast is calling for partly sunny skies today with a high of 48 degrees. We'll go over the full details of your weather forecast following this look at news. Midland native Bill Vinovich is resting this morning after leading the officiating crew in last night's Super Bowl in Las Vegas. Vinovich's crew doled out 12 penalties throughout the overtime affair, in which the Kansas City Chiefs won their third Super Bowl in 5 years with a 25-22 overtime victory over the San Francisco 49ers. Each team was assessed 6 penalties each, with the 49ers taking 40 yards worth of damage and Kansas City accumulating 55 yards. This was Vinovich's third Super Bowl as head referee, and first since these same two teams played to a similar outcome in Miami back in February of 2020. Author and Ohio U.S. Senator J.D. Vance will be the keynote speaker at the Lincoln Day dinner held by the Republican Committee of Beaver County on February 29th. Vance, who has served in the Senate since 2023 after rising to prominence with his 2016 book Hillbilly Elegy, will be bringing his insights to those in attendance at the Fez in Hopewell. The dinner will be held at 7 p.m. following a welcome reception, and tickets for the event are $50 apiece. Pre-registration for the event is required, and RSVPs can be made by going to beavercountygop.com. Hershey is cautioning on its 2024 profit growth as the company contends with rising cocoa costs that are leading to higher prices for chocolate. Cocoa futures prices have doubled over the past year and hit an all-time high of $5,874 per metric ton on Friday. Bad weather in West Africa is being blamed for damaging crop yields, which is pushing cocoa prices higher. With less than a week to go until Valentine's Day, chocolate is on the minds of many consumers, but with inflation concerns still top of mind, many shoppers are pulling back on their spending and eyeing rising food prices cautiously. Still, Hershey CEO Michelle Buck is trying to ease consumers' minds by saying, quote, "Given where cocoa prices are, we'll be using every tool in our toolbox, including pricing, as a way to manage the business," unquote. Buck said those words during the company's quarterly earnings conference call. Hershey Company anticipates its full year's earnings. Hershey Co. anticipates its full year earnings per share being relatively flat, partly due to the higher cocoa and sugar costs. Hershey stock ended Friday down 3.4%. Pennsylvania lags only slightly behind national figures for the number of working age adults who have earned college degrees or other professional certifications after high school. More details from Danielle Smith.
New data from Lumina Foundation tracks degree attainment, and the group's benchmark is that 60% of working-age adults should be earning some kind of post-high school degree by the year 2025. Right now, that number is over 53% in the Keystone State and just over 54% nationwide. Courtney Brown with the foundation says the research shows the nation is making steady progress towards the 60% goal.
We've moved from 38.1% when we began to 54.3%. That represents 16 percentage point increase in just 14 years. And that's, you know, a collective commitment and dedication to education from partners all across the country.
Brown added 42 states along with Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico saw an uptick in degree attainment last year. The increase was more than 1% in 19 states, including Pennsylvania.
Coming off a record-breaking week, Wall Street drifted towards modest losses early Monday with more corporate earnings on tap and another inflation update coming from the U.S. government. Futures for the S&P 500 were flat before the bell, while futures for the Dow Jones Industrial Average fell less than 0.1%. This week brings an important update from the Labor Department on consumer inflation. Corporate profits have mostly been better than expected for the big companies in the S&P 500 this reporting season, which is roughly two-thirds finished. Later this week, Shopify, DoorDash, and WK Kellogg report their most recent financial results.
Here's the Beaver County forecast.
Partly sunny today with a high near 50. A bit colder tonight, we may see a rain and snow mix in the early morning hours with a low of about 33. Partly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the low 40s. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
That's a look at news for now. I'm Matt Durzik for Beaver County Radio News, 99.3 FM, 1230 WBVP, and streaming live at beavercountyradio.com.
Where the listeners of Beaver County have a voice. Teleforum with Eddie Crow, 724-843-1888, 724-774-1888.
Hey, yeah, we're back. WBBPW, MBA. And you can get us at 1230 or what are the numbers, Ryan?
724-774-1888 or 724-843-1888.
Hey, we're here. If you want to call in and you have a question or you want to talk, don't hesitate. You know, I got lots to talk about, but don't hesitate to call in. And what I want to do is I want to touch base on the Fabian Society in this segment, and then we're going to talk about the history of money. And I'm going to give you the 30,000-foot view of how we got to here. You know, Ryan asked me that on the break. Running the board, thank you so much, Ryan, for a great job on the board. And he asked me, how did we get here? And we were talking about a cut that I saw and it was from Europe. I'm not sure what country it was from over the weekend, but this 30-something guy looked like he was raping a 13-year-old little girl, and some other people noticed what was going on, and they started to beat the crap out of him, and then he sat down on the ground and held his chest, pretended like he was having a heart attack, and so they let go, and he ran away. I don't know, folks, this immigration stuff that's going on has unbelievable bad potential. But I was talking about this Fabian Society. Fabian Society started in the late 1800s in Europe. It was two gentlemen, and in my research, what I found. And there, now, if you remember Europe back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, was really about socialism. I mean, that's what Europe was about at that time. And so these two military gentlemen, they wanted to devise and create a program that would take socialism around the world and everywhere. Well, it ended up in America, and one of the hot spots that I found was about 1932, 1933. And this society in the U.S. had about 7,000 members in the early 1930s. And one of those people was George Bernard Shaw. If you remember the name, if you don't, he was an influencer. He was a playwright and had a lot of famous plays that he had created. So he was very big in influencing people. And when I read some of the writings that this guy wrote, now everything I talk about, you can go onto the internet and do a search, Fabian Society. You will find it. I was on it again last night. It's all out there. So this is an information that everybody has access to. So he, in his writings, he said, you know, we have the IRS in America, and we'll talk about that later today, and we need a society, a senior society in the government, so that when you reach a certain age, you have to go present yourself to this committee and create a proof for them. In other words, a viable proof that you're still a viable person. And the next sentence that he said is, there's just a lot of people in America we need to exterminate. That was what this guy was writing about in the 30s. Orson Welles, another name. Now, he was part of this organization, but I didn't find a lot about him, and it did say that a short time as all this was evolving, he left. He figured it out, what it was and what was going on, and he left the organization. So let's come forward years. So what was the Fabian Society doing? So they were indoctrinating teachers that indoctrinate our children. Who would have ever thought at my 74 years of time on this earth, I was in the Air Force, my brother was in the Air Force, my other brother was in the Army, God rest his soul, he passed away a few years ago, my father was in the Army, my uncle was in the Army in World War II, and my dad always talked about a story. He ran wire. He was in communications in the Army and ran wire. And they were in Germany, and the Germans were in caves on this hillside. And he said they lined up two divisions of howitzers. Now, what's a howitzer 105? Now, that's a shell that's probably about 4 or 5 inches in diameter. Okay, you think of a rifle shell, you know, the side of a finger. Well, this shell is about 18 inches long, and it's about 4 or 5 inches in diameter. And a division of these guns is 112 guns. So they had two divisions of these howitzers when he told me the story. And he said they all just boom, 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 and they just barraged this mountain. And what it did is the Germans come out there bleeding out their ears because of the bursting and all that. And all the Germans could ask was, you know, where did the Americans get a machine gun cannon and the way that they did this? But that was a story of my dad's. Back to the Fabian Society. I'll try to throw in some levity and some stories along the way today. But the Fabian Society is indoctrinating our children into socialism. You know, we look at colleges today, and we look at the riots over the last several years. If you're a conservative, and you're invited in to be a speaker in a big college, I mean, Ivy League, any college, all of a sudden the students riot, and they don't want you there because you're not the liberal. You're not talking at what they have been indoctrinated into. You know, and now we have transgender guys being women and drag queens in kindergarten teaching. I'm a loss, Ryan. How did we get here?
You know, I don't know, Tom. You know, I'm thinking, I'm 45 years old. What is this going to be when I'm 20 years from now for a guy like me? My kids are going to be a little bit older. Tom, what's the our society going to look like just 20 years from now? Because this is scary. Everything that you're saying should be grabbing Americans' attentions like right now.
I totally agree with you, but I see they do interviews of people that are, they wouldn't vote for anybody but Biden. You know, that's what's going on. You got to wake up. I have a saying, please, I apologize ahead of time. Don't just stand up. You got to let it hit you in the chest because you're sitting in your chair and your butt and it's going over your head. You're not really seeing what's going on. And that's part of the problem today is people are so in, they got their head down looking at the rats and snakes at their feet that are there every day, and they're just trying to make a living and get from payday to payday, and they really don't know what's going on. And you see the interviews that they do to people and ask them, well, who's the president right now or whatever, and they're clueless. Now, here's a word for you today, Ryan, acluistic. You know?
Okay.
So those are people that are clueless. So the Fabian Society, it's where we're at. We look at teachers and the things going on. I don't know what an answer is, but I on the dark side, it eventually is going to come, I believe, to a very bad thing, because my analogy, when we talk about the $35 trillion of debt that the government has run up, and they're only going to be $2 trillion in the hole this year, you know, which is the largest annual deficit, in my mind, since the last time we were at war, to have $2 trillion plus in 1 year shortfall. And the unfunded liability is now $212 trillion. So add that together. 34, 44, 45, 46, that's $246 trillion. Now, how do you figure that out in what that is? Because nobody can comprehend what a trillion is. The politicians, they you become accustomed. You become accustomed to hearing, so trillion, oh, just $1 trillion. I mean, there's 330 million people in America, plus, another 10 or 20 million of illegal immigrants. But here we are today, and a trillion doesn't mean anything. Our politicians all need to be fired. We the people need to fire the politicians because they created this mess. Just some money, you know. Let's talk about history and finish this segment up, because the next segment is going to be exciting with Bob McEwen here, a former congressman from Ohio. So I'm looking at money. In other words, these are, and I see I got my Facebook up and running. So these are replicas of coins. And this is a $500 gold coin certificate. So at one time in our country, and we're no longer there, our currency was backed by gold and silver. Now, gold, obviously, has a higher value than silver, right, Ryan? You would agree with that.
That's correct.
Okay. So I think gold right now is close to 2,000 an ounce, or a little over, and silver is around $13-$15 an ounce. So even today, there is a difference in value between gold and silver. So the government, in their thing, they took this and they turned it into a silver certificate. So the gold coin paper became silver, but it's still a dollar denomination. So if I had a $500 certificate, gold certificate, and now I got a $500 silver certificate, did I or did I not lose some value in that transition?
Yes.
Obviously. Well, where did it go? It went to the government. The government confiscated the difference. And again, these are my perceptions. You know, when we think about things, we all have a perspective of life. But that perspective is adjusted daily by our perceptions. The people we meet, the books we read, the places we go change our perceptions in how we see things. And then all of a sudden, we have a certificate that's backed by the U.S. government. So it doesn't have any coinage on it anymore. There's one, the largest currency ever issued in America, there it is a $10,000 bill. Now, this was not in circulation. This is a Federal Reserve note, Federal Reserve. This was used to transfer money or value between one member Federal Reserve Bank and another. So this wasn't the largest bill that was in circulation was a $1,000 bill, and that went out of circulation, I don't know, about 35, 40 years ago in time. But that's $10,000, and that was traded. That's a Federal Reserve. Now, I have one here that is kind of neat, and I'll put it up there. It's a $1 million bill. Now, this is fake. It's a $1 million. This works on your mentality. In other words, when I look at that, do I have a belief in my mind that I could be worth $1 million? Do you realize that 100-person story I did? The average person today, going through their life, several $1 million are going to pass through your fingers. How much are you going to end up with? It's your decision. You are where you are because this is where you decided to be. You've made all the decisions in your life that brought you to this moment in time. And so be it. Those decisions sometimes were greatly influenced by information and people, as we all are every day on an everyday basis. We are influenced every day by people we meet, things we hear, things we read, and on and on and on. So that brings me to the last 50 or so years. And in 1968, there was a group formed called the Club of Rome. If you don't believe me, go on the internet. There it is. They're still there. They were a think tank formed in 1968 of the so-called smartest people on the planet. And there's importance to this story because we have the World Economic Forum today, which are these elite people, and they funded this group, okay? The World Economic Forum that is talking about depopulation, they funded the Club of Rome. The first projection, now the Club of Rome, their mission statement is we're going to use our intellect and our ability to see the future, and we're going to predict things that may happen in the future to try to circumvent and save society in some way and help. So their first prediction in 1968 was we're going to run out of crude oil. Imagine that. And they said by 1993, the world would be out of crude oil. Interesting. Well, there was a guy in South America, Tom Story, named Perez, and he was a world oil broker. But he also knew some people in America called the Texas Railroad Commission. Look them up. They're out there. And what do? They manage and monitor the oil production, the gas production in the United States. They're sort of America's version of OPEC, in my mind. Isn't that what OPEC does, where they're at? Well, this Perez guy saw the Texas Railroad Commission, and at that time it was believed that Saudi Arabia, under the sands of Saudi Arabia, lied 85% of all the crude oil in the world. That was the belief at that time. So this Perez guy goes to the Arabs and he says, hey, you guys got 85% of all this stuff. Imagine what you could do if you created an organization like this Texas Railroad Commission, and they formed OPEC in 1969. Oil was $1.23 a barrel of crude. 3 years later, 1972, oil was $12 a barrel of crude. That's a 1,000% increase in 3 years. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? Now, the next domino, now this is the domino effect in my 30,000-foot view. Nixon, who was president at that time, was forced to make a decision to remove us from the gold standard in America. Because up until that point, our money was backed by the gold and silver in Fort Knox, but because of this OPEC deal, and our money said payable to the bearer on demand, gold and silver, there was believed that the Arabs could clean out Fort Knox and take all of our gold away from us and in cashing in all of this money because we were importing so much oil and what was going on. So Nixon made an executive decision and disconnected our money from the gold. So we came off the gold standard. The Federal Reserve that was formed in 1913 was a banking cartel. You want to read a great book? It's called The Creature of Jekyll Island. It's a great book. It's about the history and the story of the Federal Reserve and how it was created. Started in 1913, and these business people, they were big millionaire bankers at that time. If it was today, it would be billionaires, but they were 100 millionaires plus at that time. So a bunch of bankers and a bunch of people got together on Jekyll Island. Ever heard of Jekyll Island?
I haven't.
It's a resort area off the coast of Georgia. Big resort area. Rich people go there, you know, to vacation. So these people showed up there, and in the book, it talked about a couple of them showed up like hobos. They didn't want the world to know that these people were getting together and having this meeting. So at this meeting, they designed and the Federal Reserve, what became known as the Federal Reserve, originally the banking cartel. That would tell you a message if it was still called the banking cartel. So they changed the name to the Federal Reserve when the government agreed and turned all of the monetary work over to the Federal Reserve. Now, the Federal Reserve is not federal in any way, shape, or form. They are all privately owned banks, and they make all their own rules. They are not overseen by the federal government. Well, that would be useless anyway, because most of our politicians are useless. Otherwise, we wouldn't be sitting here at $35 trillion of debt and $212 trillion of unfunded liability if they knew anything at all about managing money or managing a business in any way, shape, or form. So there it is. Now, let's come forward a little bit. And now the Federal Reserve, at that time, didn't have very much at all on their balance sheet. You know, what do you mean their balance sheet, Tom? Well, the Federal Reserve, after we went off the gold standard, had carte blanche idea they could print money from nothing and push it into the marketplace. They would use their phony counterfeited money that was counterfeited legally, and they would use it to buy assets out of the marketplace. Therefore, they would put more money into the marketplace so that the banks could loan it out using the concept of fractional banking, which we still do today. And very few people have any concept of what fractional banking is. Fractional banking is you put money in the bank, and they're going to turn the dollar you put in their bank into $7 by loans. So how does that work? So you put money in the bank. They're going to take your money and give you some interest rate, and they're going to loan that money out to other people. So when they loan it out to other people, they have to you still have to put up collateral. Did you ever make a loan, Brian, at the bank?
Yes.
Got to have collateral,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely.
So I put up collateral to get the loan at the bank. The bank now, after the documents and everything signed, actually owns my collateral. They're the owner. So they take the collateral statement, that bond, and they go to the Federal Reserve window, and they use it and they leverage more money from the Federal Reserve. On average, they can get 95 cents on the dollar from the Federal Reserve. And not too long ago, it was at 0.25% interest. And then they would take that money and loan it out to person two, who put up collateral to make the loan. They have a 5% average reserve they got to set up. So they go back, they get another 95%. From the Federal Reserve, loan it out a third time. You getting the idea what's going on here? That's fractional banking. It's actually illegal under our Constitution, what they're doing. So, and on average, they turn that seven times is what they turn. So now we look at that and say, oh, wow. Well, the Federal Reserve right now has $8 trillion on their balance sheet. That's $8 trillion of new currency they have printed from nothing and shoved it into the marketplace by buying assets, putting it on their balance sheet. Now, their balance sheet, most of this is bonds. If you remember a couple years ago, the SVB Bank, Silicon Valley Bank in California, went bust. So did several other banks. Republic, there were several of them, and they went bust. Now, why did that happen? Well, about 18 months ago, their interest rate was 0.25% in the Federal Reserve. Now it's 5.5%. That's why we're getting all these great interest rates on your savings accounts and everything. But what that's going to do, it's going to make our interest on our $35 trillion. Our interest this year is going to be over $1 trillion just in interest on the government debt. So now the Federal Reserve, they're raising interest rates. Their portfolio, if the Federal Reserve was a bank today, if they were a bank, they would be in default. For the first time in the history of the Federal Reserve, they are in the red. And where this is going to go, that's why a lot of the economists are now saying 2024, there's a big major crash coming. It could be bigger than anything since the 30s. All of this stuff has seemed to be bubbling up all at one time. Now we got these immigrants in all the major cities tearing the cities up. All this stuff going on, and it's like a volcano ready to erupt. And interesting, I saw an article that the Grand Canyon, out there, that volcanic action, they've actually closed the park because it's doing things that it hasn't ever done before. And they're afraid there's going to be a major eruption in the volcanoes there. I see we're running out of time in this segment, and but the Federal Reserve, all of this stuff going on, folks. Now think about it. These are the people that are giving you advice on telling you how to accumulate wealth and how to manage your money. I don't know, folks. How stupid do I have to be in order to take advice from these people? Now, I have all these initials after my name, so I've taken all the courses, and the only thing that I can tell you that I learned in all those courses was how to effectively take control of your money away from you and give it to the financial world. There was nothing in any of that education that taught people how to develop passive residual income, which is the only goal to have for retirement. Isn't that what you really want at retirement, Ryan?
Absolutely.
I want an unending source of income that's going to last throughout my lifetime with adjustments for inflation, and I never run out of money. But the system doesn't show you how to do that. You end up at retirement, and you have a lump sum of money. Is it enough? How much money do I have to have when I get there? I don't know. How much interest do I have to earn on the money in order to get there and have enough money to last me throughout my lifetime without running out of money and have adjustments for inflation? Well, what's the date? Well, the actual retirement date is age 87. Remember that. We'll get into that in the next to the last segment at 11:30, why the actual retirement date today is age 87. And I think we're out of time, and we're going to go to the news. We'll be back with, hopefully, Mr. McEwen after the news.
Here's the Beaver County Forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
A chilly start to the morning, otherwise partly sunny with a high near 50. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
Beaver County Radio is once again home for high school basketball this season. From the opening tip-off to the final buzzer of the state championship, we'll have all the action right here on Beaver County Radio. High school basketball coverage is being brought to you in part by Fisher's New Brighton Foodland, Friendly Federal Credit Union, The Grumpy Beaver, Patriot Home Care, Tri-County McDonald's Restaurants, Falcone's Moon Township Ford, A.K. Nahouse Appliance and Furniture Center, the St. Barnabas Health System, the Community College of Beaver County, the Beaver County Career and Technology Center, Zookie Sports Tavern, Drug Free Aliquippa, Fry Transportation, and Beaver County Radio.
Pittsburgh Penguins hockey is back on Beaver County Radio.
Crosby out the center. Tried to get around the stick of McAvoy. Does. On the backhand, centers in front. Russ flips it on net and scores. That was magical.
Tune in all season long as the revamped Pittsburgh Penguins are on a quest to win their sixth Stanley Cup championship. Penguins hockey on Beaver County Radio is being brought to you by the St. Barnabas Health System, Falcone's Moon Township Ford, Patriot Home Care, Friendly Federal Credit Union, the Keystone Wellness Program, and Beaver County Radio.
Freedom United Federal Credit Union proudly presents the return of Beaver County's number one buy-sell and trade show, Yankee Trader. The all-new Yankee Trader is back, and popular show host Diane Brocious will return to host every Saturday morning from 10:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. on Beaver County Radio. So get ready to buy, sell, and trade every Saturday right here on Beaver County Radio. The Yankee Trader Show is brought to you by your friends at Freedom United Federal Credit Union in Rochester.
You're listening to Beaver County Radio, coming to you live from the Fry Transportation Studios. Beaver County Radio and Fry Transportation, a winning team. 99.3 FM and 1230 WBVP, providing news, sports, and information for 76 years.
Here's the Beaver County Forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM. Along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com. You're listening to 99.3 FM, presented by St. Barnabas, in addition to 1230 WBVP Beaver Falls. Beaver County Radio's news source, 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP. And streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
Good morning. On this Monday, February 12th, 2024, the Beaver County weather forecast is calling for partly sunny skies today with a high of 48 degrees. We'll go over the full details of your weather forecast following this look at news. Midland native Bill Vinovich is resting this morning after leading the officiating crew in last night's Super Bowl in Las Vegas. Vinovich's crew doled out 12 penalties throughout the overtime affair, in which the Kansas City Chiefs won their third Super Bowl in 5 years with a 25-22 overtime victory over the San Francisco 49ers. Each team was assessed 6 penalties each, with the 49ers taking 40 yards worth of damage and Kansas City accumulating 55 yards. This was Vinovich's third Super Bowl as head referee, and first since these same two teams played to a similar outcome in Miami back in February of 2020. Hershey is cautioning on its 2024 profit growth as the company contends with rising cocoa costs that are leading to higher prices for chocolate. Cocoa futures prices have doubled over the past year and hit an all-time high of $5,874 per metric ton on Friday. Bad weather in West Africa is being blamed for damaging crop yields, which is pushing cocoa prices higher. With less than a week to go until Valentine's Day, chocolate is on the minds of many consumers, but with inflation concerns still top of mind, many shoppers are pulling back on their spending and eyeing rising food prices cautiously. Still, Hershey CEO Michelle Buck is trying to ease consumers' minds by saying, quote, "Given where cocoa prices are, we'll be using every tool in our toolbox, including pricing, as a way to manage the business," unquote. Buck said those words during the company's quarterly earnings conference call. Hershey Co. anticipates its full-year earnings per share being relatively flat, partly due to the higher cocoa and sugar costs. Hershey stock ended Friday down 3.4%. Pennsylvania lags only slightly behind national figures for the number of working-age adults who have earned college degrees or other professional certifications after high school. More details from Danielle Smith.
New data from Lumina Foundation tracks degree attainment, and the group's benchmark is that 60% of working-age adults should be earning some kind of post-high school degree by the year 2025. Right now, that number is over 53% in the Keystone State and just over 54% nationwide. Courtney Brown with the foundation says the research shows the nation is making steady progress towards the 60% goal.
So we've moved from 38.1% when we began to 54.3%. That represents 16 percentage point increase in just 14 years. And that's, you know, a collective commitment and dedication to education from partners all across the country.
Brown added 42 states along with Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico saw an uptick in degree attainment last year. The increase was more than 1% in 19 states, including Pennsylvania.
Police say a woman in a trench coat opened fire with a long gun inside celebrity pastor Joel Osteen's Texas megachurch before being gunned down by two off-duty officers who confronted her. The afternoon shooting at the Houston megachurch sent worshipers scrambling out of the building between busy Sunday services. Authorities say the woman was dead and a 5-year-old boy with her was critically wounded by gunfire. They also say a 57-year-old man was wounded. Houston Police Chief Troy Finner praised the officers for their quick actions. Osteen says the shooting could have been much worse if it happened during the larger 11 a.m. service. Coming off a record-breaking week, Wall Street drifted towards modest losses early Monday with more corporate earnings on tap and another inflation update coming from the U.S. government. Futures for the S&P 500 were flat before the bell, while futures for the Dow Jones Industrial Average fell less than 0.1%. This week brings an important update from the Labor Department on consumer inflation. Corporate profits have mostly been better than expected for the big companies in the S&P 500 this reporting season, which is roughly two-thirds finished. Later this week, Shopify, DoorDash, and WK Kellogg report their most recent financial results.
Here's the Beaver County forecast.
Partly sunny today with a high near 50. A bit colder tonight, we may see a rain and snow mix in the early morning hours with a low of about 33. Partly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the low 40s. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
That's a look at news for now. I'm Matt Durzik for Beaver County Radio News, 99.3 FM, 1230 WBVP, and streaming live at beavercountyradio.com.
Now, it's time to talk on Teleforum on Beaver County Radio. 1230 WBBP, 1460 WMBA, 99.3 FM, and BeaverCountyRadio.com. And now, here is the host of the show, Eddie Crow.
We're back, we're back, we're back. And my guest is holding online, and we'll get there in just a minute. Frank just brought us in a fish sandwich. The staff here at Beaver County Radio is enjoying fish sandwiches courtesy of your local McDonald's. Lenten season has arrived, so head to your local McDonald's and grab a fish fillet, a fillet sandwich today. The Beaver McDonald's will be having a teacher's night this Thursday from 4 to 6 p.m. that benefits College Square Elementary School. Don't forget that Shamrock Shakes and Shamrock McFlurries are also available for a limited time. Mr. McEwen, the Honorable Bob McEwen, are you there, sir? Oh, thank you. I can't thank you enough for giving me the time to visit today. We've been talking about a little bit of everything from the Fabian Society to the Federal Reserve and that type of thing. And did you get my email this morning with the questions on it? Okay. I just wanted to make sure you were heads up and what was going on. You're the executive director now of CNP. Let's tell us about your position at this society that you're involved in right now. Cool. I remember you spoke to my clients, I guess it's what, but 7-8 years ago, and I remember the reaction at the Seven Oaks where we were that evening was just phenomenal. And I have followed you for a long time. We have a common friend in Jody Victor, and that's where I originally, hooked up with you at. You said something a minute ago. Thank you. Right. That's exactly, yeah. Absolutely. Now, you said a comment a minute ago about George Bush, and you said installed in the White House. You want to expand on that for me a little bit? Oh, okay. Cool. The debt of the government right now, the $34.22 trillion, I have it written down here somewhere, and $212 trillion of unfunded liability. Where are we headed, Bob? What your experience in the government, and I know you're well well-minded, and where are we going? Yep, yeah. Speaker, can you put it live on speaker? Super. It's funny. You mentioned Zimbabwe, and they were printing, what, trillion-dollar bills at that time. You know, that brings me to that Saul Alinsky, and that is always the bottom line of where Obama came from and what's going on. And it's scary because in order to turn this thing around, and just in my 74 years of experience on this planet and what I have experienced and read and heard, it's going to be a mountainous problem that we're going to have to climb. This is not going to be a fun fix if it gets fixed, Bob. This is not going to be fun for and the average person is going to it. You know, it's just the illegals. The riots, I believe, in the near future are going to be so severe like never before in America. Yeah, well, I'm glad we've got about five more minutes, and because we already took care of that, so we wouldn't have to stop during our conversation. So, I want to get all of you that I can today.
Well, here's what I want to say about everything that you said, Tom, is exactly correct, but that's why history is so good, because I just want to remind you that we've not always done the right thing. In the 1930s, when Hitler was moving across Europe. When he moved into the demilitarized zone of the Rhineland, and in violation of the Treaty of Versailles at the end of World War One, we know that every soldier had retreat orders on their person, because the army in France was so the army in Germany was so pathetic that all you had to do is a paper, you just push it and it would collapse. The army in France, which is the border that he was marching into, the army in France was 11 times greater than the army in Germany. But Hitler said, there's no leadership on the other side. Watch, when I violate this, they're not going to do anything. And when he did it, then he became more popular. Then he moved into Austria, became more and more popular. It could have been stopped for an entire decade, and nobody did anything. As a result, we lost 55 million people. At the end of World War II, we owned the world. We were the only nuclear power. We had defeated Imperial Japan. We controlled all of Europe. Could have done anything that we wanted to, but the State Department and the folks in MI5 in London turned those countries over to the communists. And every election, as Stalin said, and we don't care who votes, we just care who counts the votes. And so in Ukraine, in Romania, in Poland, in Czechoslovakia, in Bulgaria, in every one of those countries, they all went all during 1947, 48, 49, 50. Finally, in 49, who lost China under Truman? We supported Mao Zedong to turn the Chinese communist. So if you were looking at that time when you could, the whole world could have been free, you would have to be very depressed. Fortunately, in 1952, Eisenhower won. The only election that took place after that time was in Austria. And in Austria in 1954, the Americans asserted themselves, and Austria had a fair election, and Austria is free. But I submit, had we not lost the 1948 election, we wouldn't have had 50 years of a Cold War. So there's times when things go haywire, when we miss opportunities. So right now, when you see that what we're doing is messing up a great opportunity, we can say, isn't this horrible? Well, yes, it is. And it has been that way in the past. But I'm here to tell you that China is a bigger bubble than America. They have whole cities, not just buildings there. They have nothing in. They have whole cities there that are just a bubble. America has twice as much non-natural resources, has land. 85% of the land in Nevada is controlled by the federal government. If we sold off some of our land to take down that debt, the potential of doing what is right for America, this nation could take off like a rocket. How do I know that? Because 4 years ago, in 2017, 2018, we did it. And we went to energy independence. We went to peace in the Middle East. We went to a strong military. And so it just is a question of leadership. And I think we're on the cusp of actually blowing it all.
Yep.
We have the capacity to take off like a rocket.
Yeah, we're running out of time. And I could listen to you all day, and I can't thank you enough, because you just sort of validated my thinking. You know, we've got to downsize the government by 75%, and I believe, you know, government assets that have been acquired for years and years and years, if they were moved back to the private marketplace and operated at profit and a capital marketplace, I mean, it's just, there's no concept of where we could actually go. I want to thank you so much, my friend, and for coming on here today with your insights and everything. And if you will email me a mailing address, I'd love to send you a gift for visiting us today. You have my email address, so if you'd send me a mailing address, just do that for me so I can send you. I'll send you an autographed copy of my book and one thing, but I'll send you a gift in addition to that, Bob. God bless you. Thank you so much. God bless, my friend. Bye-bye. Well, folks, there it is. I the people on Facebook, I apologize, but this is being done on their Facebook, so hopefully they heard the call. So I will be able to post that in what we're doing. We have another guest at 10:30. Ryan, is there any way that we can get the volume out instead of just in the microphones?
I'm going to work on that on a break.
Okay. Yeah. So with that, we're going to take a break, and we're going to do the news, and then we'll be back for the next segment, and we're going to talk about life insurance and the truth.
Beaver County Radio's news source, 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
Good morning. On this Monday, February 12th, 2024, the Beaver County weather forecast is calling for partly sunny skies today with a high of 48 degrees. We'll go over the full details of your weather forecast following this look at news. Midland native Bill Vinovich is resting this morning after leading the officiating crew in last night's Super Bowl in Las Vegas. Vinovich's crew doled out 12 penalties throughout the overtime affair, in which the Kansas City Chiefs won their third Super Bowl in 5 years with a 25-22 overtime victory over the San Francisco 49ers. Each team was assessed 6 penalties each, with the 49ers taking 40 yards worth of damage and Kansas City accumulating 55 yards. This was Vinovich's third Super Bowl as head referee, and first since these same two teams played to a similar outcome in Miami back in February of 2020. Hershey is cautioning on its 2024 profit growth as the company contends with rising cocoa costs that are leading to higher prices for chocolate. Cocoa futures prices have doubled over the past year and hit an all-time high of $5,874 per metric ton on Friday. Bad weather in West Africa is being blamed for damaging crop yields, which is pushing cocoa prices higher. With less than a week to go until Valentine's Day, chocolate is on the minds of many consumers, but with inflation concerns still top of mind, many shoppers are pulling back on their spending and eyeing rising food prices cautiously. Still, Hershey CEO Michelle Buck is trying to ease consumers' minds by saying, quote, "Given where cocoa prices are, we will be using every tool in our toolbox, including pricing, as a way to manage the business," unquote. Buck said those words during the company's quarterly earnings conference call. Hershey Co. anticipates its full-year earnings per share being relatively flat, partly due to the higher cocoa and sugar costs. Hershey stock ended Friday down 3.4%. Pennsylvania lags only slightly behind national figures for the number of working-age adults who have earned college degrees or other professional certifications after high school. More details from Danielle Smith.
New data from Lumina Foundation tracks degree attainment, and the group's benchmark is that 60% of working-age adults should be earning some kind of post-high school degree by the year 2025. Right now, that number is over 53% in the Keystone State and just over 54% nationwide. Courtney Brown with the foundation says the research shows the nation is making steady progress towards the 60% goal.
We've moved from 38.1% when we began to 54.3%. That represents 16 percentage point increase in just 14 years. And that's, you know, a collective commitment and dedication to education from partners all across the country.
Brown added 42 states along with Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico saw an uptick in degree attainment last year. The increase was more than 1% in 19 states, including Pennsylvania.
Police say a woman in a trench coat opened fire with a long gun inside celebrity pastor Joel Osteen's Texas megachurch before being gunned down by two off-duty officers who confronted her. The afternoon shooting at the Houston megachurch sent worshipers scrambling out of the building between busy Sunday services. Authorities say the woman was dead and a 5-year-old boy with her was critically wounded by gunfire. They also say a 57-year-old man was wounded. Houston Police Chief Troy Finner praised the officers for their quick actions. Osteen says the shooting could have been much worse if it happened during the larger 11 a.m. service. Coming off a record-breaking week, Wall Street drifted towards modest losses early Monday with more corporate earnings on tap and another inflation update coming from the U.S. government. Futures for the S&P 500 were flat before the bell, while futures for the Dow Jones Industrial Average fell less than 0.1%. This week brings an important update from the Labor Department on consumer inflation. Corporate profits have mostly been better than expected for the big companies in the S&P 500 this reporting season, which is roughly two-thirds finished. Later this week, Shopify, DoorDash, and WK Kellogg report their most recent financial results.
Here's the Beaver County forecast.
Partly sunny today with a high near 50. A bit colder tonight, we may see a rain and snow mix in the early morning hours with a low of about 33. Partly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the low 40s. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
That's a look at news for now. I'm Matt Durzik for Beaver County Radio News, 99.3 FM, 1230 WBVP, and streaming live at beavercountyradio.com.
Love is in the air, and Valentine's Day is just around the corner. Why fight the crowds by going out to dinner? Cook dinner at home and let the East Rochester and Tuscan Shop and Save be your one-stop shop for you to spoil your Valentine. For starters, at the East Rochester and Tuscan Shop and Save, you can get your sweetheart flowers for the table and beer or wine to sip on as you wait for the main course. They have surf and turf, as well as a variety of steaks, seafoods, and chicken, along with everything else that you need for that special meal. The bakery at East Rochester and Tuscan Shop and Save has treats as sweet as your sweetheart, like heart-shaped mini cupcakes and chocolate chip cookies. They also have Valentine-themed cakes, cupcakes, and pastries of multiple varieties. Finish that up with that perfect greeting card, and you will be set for the perfect romantic evening at home. While at East Rochester Shop and Save, take a look at the True Value Hardware. They have everything you need for your next project. That's the East Rochester and Tuscan Shop and Save.
Talk about what's happening in Beaver County or around the world on Teleforum, 724-843-1888, 724-774-1888. It's Teleforum with Eddie Crow.
Hello, 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 everybody. We're back, and our next guest is Kim Butler. And Kim, are you there? It is so good, and I want to thank you so much for agreeing to come on today. We've had a lot of discussion. The gentleman before you was the Honorable Bob McEwen, formerly congressman from Ohio, and we talked about money and the banks and the Federal Reserve and a little bit of everything that we've talked about so far today. But I really want to – you've written six books now, seven books. You have another one on the way. Busting the budget lies and that, and your books, ladies and gentlemen, this lady has been in the financial business for 30 plus years, author, busting the college planning, busting the real estate lies, busting retirement planning lies, busting the financial planning lies, live your life insurance. These books make a statement, folks, and Kim, I look as one of my best friends and mentors in my life, and we think a lot similar in the way that we work with our clients and everything. But Kim is very, very unique. Her husband, Todd, I have to mention Todd. I've known Todd for 35 years. He is a writer of software, and the software that Todd has created that Kim uses and I use is the software that actually proves everything we're going to talk about in the next 25 minutes or so. Kimberly, in your words, tell me about your process and what you do. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Cool. And when we talk about your process, how do people get a hold of you? Okay. Everybody hear that? ProsperityThinkers.com. Kim has clients from all over the world. We have conferences, and I've been to her meetings and everything. It's just amazing that there is a growing number of us that have a different philosophy. As I said earlier in the program, I have all these initials after my name, and the biggest thing I learned about all that education was how to take control of everybody's money and turn it over to the financial world and renders everybody to be in that 95% of dead or dead broke when they reach retirement in what they do. Now, in your books, tell me a little bit about some of your books and how they evolved. You've been listening to the Garrett, I see. No, when I talk to people, the principles that you talk about, the think, you got to think. And everything starts with the 6 inches between our ears. Because if you're not thinking properly, you can never come up with the right answers. And people struggle their whole life to come up with retirement. And when they don't know how much money to save, They chase interest rates because they think that's going to be the answer. And chasing interest rates leads you to risk. And they think that's the answer. If I don't find that Microsoft or Walmart stock, that magic stock that turns into billions of dollars someday, I guess I'm not going to make it. And it's funny that they do that. But how do you handle clients when you're on the phone and they struggle with being able to believe what you're telling them? You know, when we look at the products, and I really want to get, I want to go to this magic product that you and I are aware of, life insurance. And let me set it up, folks, for you, because life insurance, as soon as somebody says life insurance, you know, if I were at a party and people knew I was a life insurance agent, I would be like the plague. Nobody would even come near me. Nobody would even have a conversation with me because of their perception of what they think about or what life insurance is. But my answer is very simple. There's 800-plus life insurance companies out there selling some form of life insurance. 99.8% of all those companies are corporations that have allegiance to stockholders. They are not. And the other fraction of a percent, point something, are dividend-paying mutual life insurance companies. And people just aren't aware of those companies. But yet when I look at the Federal Reserve and look at banks, and they've got 20, 30, even as much as 40% of their Tier 1 reserves, and the Tier 1 reserve has to be kept absolutely safe, the Federal Reserve is alluding at that this position has the least amount of, least chance of default. So how do you communicate the life? And tell me about your philosophy, your teaching with life insurance with people. How do you break that barrier that is preconceived notions that people have? Now, how do you access this cash? It's interesting when I meet people. I mean, if they make $75,000 a year, $100,000, or $200,000 a year, the answer is really simple. That because of the way we have been taught, because of the perceptions that have been arrived at between our ears, most people lose a minimum over their lifetime of $3 million or more in just simply the way that we do things. I meet people, and I'm sure you do, you know, they're struggling, they're getting close to retirement, and they're, you know, how am I going to solve this problem? And sometimes it gets very, very hard. So if you were talking to a young family, 35, 40 years old, got a couple of little kiddos and that, where would your picture, what would your picture look like after you met with them and started planning with them? What would that look like? No, they never dug the hole. They, you know, it's like building a building, and when you dig the hole, instead of putting in a foundation, you put the roof in. You know, that people, in my experience, and I'm sure you would reiterate that, people have been trained to think wrongly. It's the essence of the society we live in, that I want it now. You know, we're in this push-button society, and I want it now. And it's very hard for people to think long term. And that was always, you know, Nelson Nash, the infinite banking concept. And he always said, you got to think long term in everything that you do. And we're running down of time, and we have about a minute to go. What message would you give everybody, Kim? What would you share with everybody if you could? Thank you so much, Kim. I will talk to you again soon. I can't thank you enough for coming on and sharing your thoughts with us today. Folks, this is Kim Butler. She lives in rural Texas and has her own alpaca farm, and her and Todd. I love you both. I will talk to you again soon. Thank you so much, Kim. God bless, dear. Bye-bye. Well, folks, there it is. And between Bob McEwen and Kim Butler, and then when we come back, we're gonna put the cherry on top and some whipped cream. So,
Beaver County Radio proudly welcomes Fry Transportation to their family. You're listening to 99.3 FM and 1230 WBVP, live from the all-new Fry Transportation Studios.
Back by popular demand, the first Friday of every month from 9, 10 to noon. It's the Beaver County Radio 1968 VW Remote Bus and the Time Machine with Frank Sparks and Eddie Crow. Frank and Eddie will be going back in time, celebrating some of the greatest moments and music of the mid to late 20th century. They'll also be taking your calls and talking about what was going on in Beaver County back in the day. Mark your calendars each month so you don't miss the monthly appearance of the Time Machine. So take me away. I don't mind, but you better promise me I'll be back in time. The first Friday of every month from 9:10 a.m. to noon, right here on Beaver County Radio.
Pittsburgh Penguins hockey is back on Beaver County Radio.
Crosby out the center. Tried to get around the stick, and McAvoy does. On the backhand, centers in front. Russ flips it on net and scores! That was magical!
Tune in all season long as the revamped Pittsburgh Penguins are on a quest to win their sixth Stanley Cup championship. Penguins hockey on Beaver County Radio is being brought to you by the St. Barnabas Health System, Falcone's Moon Township Board, Patriot Home Care, Friendly Federal Credit Union, the Keystone Wellness Program, and Beaver County Radio.
You're listening to 99.3 FM, presented by St. Barnabas, in addition to 1230 WBVP Beaver Falls. Beaver County Radio's news source, 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
Good morning. On this Monday, February 12, 2024, the Beaver County weather forecast is calling for partly sunny skies today with a high of 48 degrees. We'll go over the full details of your weather forecast following this look at news. Midland native Bill Vinovich is resting this morning after leading the officiating crew in last night's Super Bowl in Las Vegas. Vinovich's crew doled out 12 penalties throughout the overtime affair, in which the Kansas City Chiefs won their third Super Bowl in 5 years with a 25-22 overtime victory over the San Francisco 49ers. Each team was assessed 6 penalties each, with the 49ers taking 40 yards worth of damage and Kansas City accumulating 55 yards. This was Vinovich's third Super Bowl as head referee, and first since these same two teams played to a similar outcome in Miami back in February of 2020. Hershey is cautioning on its 2024 profit growth as the company contends with rising cocoa costs that are leading to higher prices for chocolate. Cocoa futures prices have doubled over the past year and hit an all-time high of $5,874 per metric ton on Friday. Bad weather in West Africa is being blamed for damaging crop yields, which is pushing cocoa prices higher. With less than a week to go until Valentine's Day, chocolate is on the minds of many consumers, but with inflation concerns still top of mind, many shoppers are pulling back on their spending and eyeing rising food prices cautiously. Still, Hershey CEO Michelle Buck is trying to ease consumers' minds by saying, quote, "Given where cocoa prices are, we'll be using every tool in our toolbox, including pricing, as a way to manage the business," unquote. Buck said those words during the company's quarterly earnings conference call. Hershey Co. anticipates its full-year earnings per share being relatively flat, partly due to the higher cocoa and sugar costs. Hershey stock ended Friday down 3.4%. Pennsylvania lags only slightly behind national figures for the number of working-age adults who have earned college degrees or other professional certifications after high school. More details from Danielle Smith.
New data from Lumina Foundation tracks degree attainment, and the group's benchmark is that 60% of working-age adults should be earning some kind of post-high school degree by the year 2025. Right now, that number is over 53% in the Keystone State and just over 54% nationwide. Courtney Brown with the foundation says the research shows the nation is making steady progress towards the 60% goal.
We've moved from 38.1% when we began to 54.3%. That represents 16 percentage point increase in just 14 years. And that's, you know, a collective commitment and dedication to education from partners all across the country.
Brown added 42 states along with Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico saw an uptick in degree attainment last year. The increase was more than 1% in 19 states, including Pennsylvania.
Police say a woman in a trench coat opened fire with a long gun inside celebrity pastor Joel Osteen's Texas megachurch before being gunned down by two off-duty officers who confronted her. The afternoon shooting at the Houston megachurch sent worshipers scrambling out of the building between busy Sunday services. Authorities say the woman was dead and a 5-year-old boy with her was critically wounded by gunfire. They also say a 57-year-old man was wounded. Houston Police Chief Troy Finner praised the officers for their quick actions. Osteen says the shooting could have been much worse if it happened during the larger 11 a.m. service. Coming off a record-breaking week, Wall Street drifted towards modest losses early Monday with more corporate earnings on tap and another inflation update coming from the U.S. government. Futures for the S&P 500 were flat before the bell, while futures for the Dow Jones Industrial Average fell less than 0.1%. This week brings an important update from the Labor Department on consumer inflation. Corporate profits have mostly been better than expected for the big companies in the S&P 500 this reporting season, which is roughly two-thirds finished. Later this week, Shopify, DoorDash, and WK Kellogg report their most recent financial results.
Here's the Beaver County forecast.
Partly sunny today with a high near 50. A bit colder tonight, we may see a rain and snow mix in the early morning hours with a low of about 33. Partly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the low 40s. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
That's a look at news for now. I'm Matt Durzik for Beaver County Radio News, 99.3 FM, 1230 WBVP, and streaming live at beavercountyradio.com.
Talk about what's happening in Beaver County or around the world on Teleforum, 724-843-1888, 724-774-1888. It's Teleform with Eddie Crow.
Where has the time gone today? We still have another hour to go, and the next half hour, I want to talk about, you know, all the things that we typically do, and we don't realize that the things that we have been taught to do, that we typically do, don't necessarily create any success for our futures at all in what we do. Now, we had Bob McEwen on and talking about, you know, the government and what's going on and for the people, by the people. Ryan and I were just talking about President Trump. I are one of those MAGA people, and I say that here with confidence in nothing more than, you know, where do the politicians go to school to learn how to be a politician? Where do they learn how to run a government in what they do? So obviously, even if there was such a place, you have to step back and look at the results that they have created. You know, $35 trillion of debt, $212 trillion of unfunded liability. It became the mantra of a politician. They got elected. They said all these great things in their campaign on what they were going to do and on and on and on. And they get to Washington, D.C., and something seems to happen. You know, what happened? I have no way of knowing or explaining it, but something obviously happens when they get to Washington, D.C. They realize that they don't know anything on how to run a government, and now they are folded into the blanket of politicians. And I always have this little saying, you know, the word politics has a meaning. Poly is many, and ticks are blood-sucking insects. And I'm sorry to have to say that, But many of our politicians, they're money sucking insects. And how do you go to Washington and make $100,000, $120,000, $130,000 a year, and 10, 15, 20 years later, you come out worth $10 million, $20 million, $30 million, $100 million? How does that happen? So obviously there is something sort of messed up with the system. We were talking earlier about fractional banking and where that happened and what came into being. Well, fractional banking started in the 70s, and then through the 70s and into the 80s, and Ronald Reagan came on the scene, who was a conservative. If you read any of Ronald Reagan's memoirs, you will realize that in 1952, he made a movie called Bonzo Goes to Washington. And that movie made Ronald Reagan the first actor in history to make a $1 million paycheck for making a movie. And he talks about the day that he went to the paymaster's trailer on the lot to pick up his check. And looking at his check, the check had $900,000 withholding. $900,000 withholding? Out of $1 million? Well, the marginal tax bracket at that time, the highest marginal bracket was 92%. So if you made $1 million, you reached the marginal tax rate of 92%. So after all the tax deductions, he ended up with $100,000 out of $1 million check. Now let's study that a little bit. You know, we talked earlier about the Federal Reserve and the creature of Jekyll Island, the book written about him. And I'm working on a new book, The Scoundrels of Finance, is the working title on my book right now. But in my book, in my research about the Federal Reserve, which was a group of business people that were multimillionaires and millionaire bankers that put together the Federal Reserve, but there was, in my mind, Tom's opinion, in my mind, there was another meeting that happened somewhere in America by a bunch of these people that were mega wealthy at that time, and they were institutional or instrumental in creating the IRS, because the IRS, the Internal Revenue Service, was also created about that time. And it was originally thought, well, we need to capture money to pay for World War I and what went on there, and on and on and on. So these people that were mega rich then, if it was today's dollars, they would have been the billionaires that we have today. And they wanted to create an IRS, an Internal Revenue Service, that would control taxes and the cost of creating wealth. So in the 30s and that, some of the marginal rates were like 60%, 70%, and so forth. So, and then it got up in the late 30s to 90%, 92%, and there we are. So what does that mean? Let's step back and look. At they were instrumental in consulting the government as business people, as rich business people, to get the government to create this IRS. And the IRS is nothing more than the collector of your tax monies. So if the tax rate in 1937, 36, if you made $200,000, the next dollar you earned had a 94% tax rate. 94%. So their collusion, their conspiracy was to create an onerous tax cycle that it would be impossible for you to become as wealthy as them. Does that make sense to you with what I'm talking about? You know, so they wanted this controlling factor over how much money you make. Well, isn't that what we have today? Now, there are business people today. I own a business. And I always tell people when I talk to people, when you're an employee of a company, when you get your paycheck, you get they take all the expenses out first, right? They take the taxes and the local taxes and all of that stuff comes out of you and you get what's left. I'm a business person. I get 100% of the revenue that comes into my business and I get to spend and pay for things, okay? But I get the money 100% first. In other words, it's just the way the tax code is. And I remember they just played this clip of the debate between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. And Hillary Clinton accused Donald Trump of not paying his taxes. You know, he had these millions and millions of dollars that he had earned and didn't pay any income tax. And Donald Trump responded, he says, well, that's the tax code. That's what it allows me to do. I did what was legal, and I was able to not pay taxes because of the tax code. And he looked at her and he said, if you want me to pay more taxes, you created the tax code. You need to change the tax code. But Hillary, you're not going to change the tax code because you know what? All of your donors and your supporters take the same tax breaks that I take that is created in the system. And it's like social engineering. Let me say, bring something new into the equation here, and I would refer to it as social engineering. So they manipulate the tax code to get average everyday people to do things the way they want them done. It's like Section 8 housing. You know, if I'm a real estate investor and I make houses available for low income and government subsidized housing, I have a lot of extra tax breaks because I made my rental property Section 8 housing. And if you don't know what that is, you look it up. But it's a special way to manage your rental properties and get more tax credits and tax benefits from the government in the way you manage your money. Well, why does that make it fair? I don't know, but some government committee, those politicians sitting in a little room somewhere, decided, well, we need more of this or more of that, and how can we incentivize the people that have the money to do things the way we want them to do it, and they create tax incentives, and it's nothing more than what I would refer to as social engineering. And we're at half after the hour, so we're going to take a break, and we're going to come back, and we're going to talk about Greenspan and the Federal Reserve some more.
Here's the Beaver County forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
A chilly start to the morning, otherwise partly sunny with a high near 50. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
Time to kiss your old ride goodbye and say be mine to a new or used vehicle at Moon Township Ford. It's February and Ford F-150s are looking better than ever at finance rates that are better than ever too. The Ford F-150 is famous for its durability and strength with incredible hauling and towing capacity. Moon Township Ford also has a great selection of pre-owned vehicles, especially trucks and several nice SUVs too. There's plenty in stock to help you find your perfect match. It's time to fall in love with a new Ford. Moon Township Ford, University Boulevard, where friends send friends.
Keeping warm this winter won't be easy unless you rely on McGee Heating and Air Conditioning. They've been keeping you comfortable in the winter and summer for over 60 years now. That's how long families just like yours have been relying on McGee for all your heating and cooling needs. There's still lots of cold days ahead, so there's still lots of time to call McGee for a furnace check or any heating problem you may have. Call 724-375-7112 for an appointment today and stay warm from your friends at McGee Heating and Air Conditioning, family owned and operated, Main Street, Aliquippa.
If you're a parent that's already watched plenty of youth baseball or soccer games, you know the value of teamwork. Whether it's the team on the field or your team of family members at home, strengthening that group can pay off in many ways. Keystone Wellness Programs is offering their free Strengthening Families program in Beaver County for families of children ages 10 to 14. Learn how to increase family bonding and communications all while having fun together. Visit KeystoneWellnessPrograms.org for details.
You worked hard for it. Why not earn more on your savings? You can with a Farmers Building and Savings Bank Passbook Savings Account. A Farmers Passbook offers a premium interest rate higher than most local financial institutions. This account gives you immediate access to your money with no penalties. It's FDIC insured, and imagine this, it's not internet accessible. This account is safe from hackers. It's your money, so why tie it up long term when you can earn more at Farmers? And if you're in need of money, a Farmers Building Home Equity Loan is an excellent way to cash in on up to 80% of your home's equity. Perfect for fix-up projects, bill consolidation, or that once-in-a-lifetime vacation. Farmers Building and Savings Bank simplifies the loan process to make borrowing easy. Stop in or call 724-774-4970. That's 724-774-4970. Beaver County employees serving Beaver County residents. Farmers Building and Savings Bank on the Park in Rochester. Banking made simple since 1894. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Hey folks, I'm back. It's Tom Young, and we're here lighting up the airways. I have my own Facebook Live, and I've got some folks on here that are local, and I got a couple of folks listening from Zimbabwe or South Africa. We talked about Zimbabwe earlier, and that was several years ago. Zimbabwe was taken over by Mugabe, and after about 10 years of that dictator, they had buried the country in the economy, so they were just printing money. And they were printing trillion-dollar bills. He figured, I can just print money out of debt. You know, I can print money out of the problem. And Bob mentioned even after World War II, Germany, you know, it took a wheelbarrow load of marks to buy bread and milk. And that was what happened to the money back then. And that's what we see happening to our money today. As we've talked about the Federal Reserve and fractional banking, now let's go back to our story and continue the story on. In 1987, the savings and loan industry in America went bust. Now, what was that? Well, there's a couple things that happened. Now, Ronald Reagan was president, and in 1986, the Congress and the Senate were all Democratic. And so they negotiated a settlement to change the tax code. And the key ingredient that they changed in the tax code was the depreciation schedule on commercial real estate, where if you owned prior to this change, if you owned commercial real estate, you could depreciate the property, the building, the structure on the property, because you can't depreciate the land, only the structure, you could depreciate it for 19 years. So if you take 1/19th a year of the value, that would be a pretty heavy tax deduction to reduce your taxable income. So there was a huge tax benefit. And if Ryan, if you and I went together to buy a $1 million building prior to that tax change, we would each put up $50,000 to buy this $1 million building, and we would get a $900,000 mortgage on this property. And the value of the property is the appraised value is based on the rental income of the property, the tax benefits, in other words, how much tax we have to pay on that rental income. So the idea was to come down to the net rental income, the net cash flow on that property, which was the key ingredient to determining the value at $1 million. So we buy this property, put up $50,000 each. So a year later, Congress comes along in collusion with Ronald Reagan and negotiation and the tax code changes dealing with depreciation on our building. And it went from 19 years to 39 years. So imagine the tax write-off that we lost by going from 19-year depreciation to 39 years depreciation. So now when you come down to the net bottom line cash flow on the building after taxes and expenses and depreciation, our building is now appraised at $750,000, not $1 million. So you and I are sitting here having a meeting, and we're talking about, what the heck are we going to do? We got a $900,000 mortgage on a property that's only worth $750,000. So we make a collective decision, and there's the keys. We take the keys down and throw them on the table down at the savings and loan where we have our mortgage and say, it's all yours, baby. You know, we're not going to pay anymore, and we're going to take our loss of $50,000 each and walk away from this property. Well, that happened all across America. The Glendale Savings and Loan in California was the largest savings and loan in the country that defaulted because of this. And the defaults, the savings and loan industry had their own insurance. It was called FSLIC. We know banks have FDIC, okay? So savings and loan was FSLIC. And there was so much default and failure that it collapsed the FSLIC. And do you know of any savings and loans anywhere today, Ryan? They're gone. Yeah. A few of them that were locally, Farmers in Rochester was a very, very strong reserve bank, and they, a savings and loan at one time, and they became a bank. So a few of the savings loans became banks, but basically they went away. The Glendale Savings and Loan in California, they actually sued the federal government. They couldn't win anything, but it was a point that they tried to make. And they actually won the lawsuit. And the blame for their collapse, which is a couple of $1 billion, was the fault of the federal government in the way that they changed the tax law in the tax code dealing with commercial real estate. So that was 87. And now, a little bit more history. If you go back prior to 1970, banks and savings and loans operated on two different planes. They didn't do a lot similar. Most mortgages were in savings and loans. Banks did a few, but mainly mortgages on real estate was in savings and loans. And that's why it was such a big problem in 87. But over the years, now, prior to 1970, the banks were not allowed to offer you a checking account that paid interest. But don't we have checking accounts today that pay interest? Well, there was a little bank up in New England that created a savings account that had checks with it. In other words, you could write a voucher on a savings account. So it was a checkable account tied to a savings account. And that was the beginning that opened the door that what became known as now accounts, super now accounts. You had to have $10,000 balance in the account to make interest and on and on and on. So that was the opening of the door. And that was the beginning of the road narrowing. And eventually the banks and the savings loans were on the same road. So if the savings and loans collapsed in 87, what do you think was going to happen to the banks? By 1990, there were four major U.S. banks that their margin of safety was getting so thin that they were almost ready to be taken over by the government and default. We're talking three of the four were the three biggest banks in the country at that time, and if they would have defaulted, they would have buried the FDIC the same as the FSLIC. So Alan Greenspan was brought into the Federal Reserve in 1990. And if you and I went down to the bank in 1990 and said, Mr. Banker, I want to make a loan. And they said, well, you know, we're going to charge you 15% interest. And you say, well, what about savings? What are you paying on CDs? He says, oh, we're paying 9. Okay, they're going to pay me 9 to get my money to loan it out to you at 15. So they made 6% gross profit over 9 costs. So they made 66 2/3% gross profit on that transaction. Very understandable. So 18 months later, Greenspan, through a program of lowering the interest rates, and if you remember, that was the crash of the interest rates that led down to the zero interest rate we've had in the last 15, 20 years till the Federal Reserve. And we'll get to the story of today and what's going on. But here we are. Interest rates, you go back to the bank 18 months later, it's now 1992, and say, Mr. Banker, I want to make a loan. Oh, you're going to like us. We're only charging 9 today. Well, what about savings? What are you paying on savings? Well, we're only going to pay you 3. Okay, so CDs were now at 3%. But if you remember during the 80s, 1980, 81, prime rate in America went to 21.5%, right after Jimmy Carter, right at the end of Jimmy Carter. 21.5%. So if you had a business loan with 2 over prime, it was 23.5% interest on a business loan. A lot of businesses went bankrupt and blah, blah, blah. So we had high interest rates during the decade of the 80s. You could buy a 10-year CD yielding 6% compounded for 10 years. You could also get a 30-year fixed-rate mortgage, and the interest rate was 16%. So those were the times of the 80s that came out of that. Now, what transpired is sort of what's going on today, and why haven't we gone back up to those severe high interest rates where in the last 18 months it went from 0.25% interest to 5.5%, and now the Feds have stopped. We'll get to that in a minute, but back to the banks. So Greenspan effectively lowered the rates. So if I got to pay 3 to get your money and I can still make 6 in the spread, isn't that 200%, 6 over 3? So in 1993, Wall Street Journal headlined, front page, the most profitable year in the history of U.S. banking. Well, gee whiz. Well, Greenspan was the hero. Well, where did the money come from? They stole it from us. It was our money by paying lower and lower interest. It was our money that they stole from us to bail out the banks because the fat, big Wall Street elites made decisions. And that also led to 2008. And 2008 was the big crash. Well, what caused the crash? Again, 1999, now this was after the savings and loans and the banks were made it, and Greenspan lowered the interest rate down to near nothing during the 90s. Well, what did that do to the stock market? Ooh, we had this zoom during the 90s. By 1998 or 99, people quit putting money in their 401ks because they believed they were going to make so much money on their 401ks, they were going to be multimillionaires when they reached retirement. Because of the dot-com boom, and computers became an IT and blah, blah, blah. And then 2000 came and the next crash. So 2000 and 2001 was a 40% crash. And I'm looking at the time, and we're coming up on 29. So we're going to go to break here, and we're going to come back after the break. And we're going to finish up this little story of the Federal Reserve. Then we're going to talk about the positives. All of this negative stuff, there are solutions, folks. We're going to talk about them and how you can find them. God bless. We'll see you after the news.
Stop by your local McDonald's today and pick up everyone's favorites, the Shamrock Shake and Oreo Shamrock McFlurry, now available through March 24th. Don't miss out on these fan favorites. Shamrock Shake and Oreo Shamrock McFlurry, now at McDonald's. I'm loving it.
As your life evolves, so should your furniture. The new Flex Modular Seating Furniture by FlexSteel at AK Nahas changes with your lifestyle. Durable, stain-resistant, sustainable, easily customized, discover Flex. This President's Day, take an extra 15% off our low price on your FlexSteel purchase and save an additional 10% off your FlexSteel furniture purchase, along with free local delivery and 12-month special financing. Only at AK Nahas. You'll do okay with AK.
Do you wish that you had the support of a family in your financial institution? You can when you become a family member at Friendly Federal Credit Union. This is Cindy Haladio. During February, the month of showing love and appreciation, Friendly Federal Credit Union wants to show you how true it really is. If you haven't already, apply for membership at Friendly Federal Credit Union with offices in Eloquip and Baden. Enjoy low or no fees with your account, favorable terms and interest rates, and the added benefit of putting money back into your community. What are you waiting for? It's time for a family reunion. Join the thousands of other local people who are already part of the friendliest family in Beaver County. The member owners at the place that makes more sense for you. Friendly Federal Credit Union. Member NCUA Equal Housing Lender.
Friendly Federal Credit Union.
Beaver County Radio's news source, 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBBP, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
Good morning. On this Monday, February 12, 2024, the Beaver County weather forecast is calling for partly sunny skies today with a high of 48 degrees. We'll go over the full details of your weather forecast following this look at news. Midland native Bill Vinovich is resting this morning after leading the officiating crew in last night's Super Bowl in Las Vegas. Vinovich's crew doled out 12 penalties throughout the overtime affair, in which the Kansas City Chiefs won their third Super Bowl in 5 years with a 25-22 overtime victory over the San Francisco 49ers. Each team was assessed 6 penalties each, with the 49ers taking 40 yards worth of damage and Kansas City accumulating 55 yards. This was Vinovich's third Super Bowl as head referee, and first since these same two teams played to a similar outcome in Miami back in February of 2020. Hershey is cautioning on its 2024 profit growth as the company contends with rising cocoa costs that are leading to higher prices for chocolate. Cocoa futures prices have doubled over the past year and hit an all-time high of $5,874 per metric ton on Friday. Bad weather in West Africa is being blamed for damaging crop yields, which is pushing cocoa prices higher. With less than a week to go until Valentine's Day, chocolate is on the minds of many consumers, but with inflation concerns still top of mind, many shoppers are pulling back on their spending and eyeing rising food prices cautiously. Still, Hershey CEO Michelle Buck is trying to ease consumers' minds by saying, quote, "Given where cocoa prices are, we'll be using every tool in our toolbox, including pricing, as a way to manage the business," unquote. Buck said those words during the company's quarterly earnings conference call. Hershey Co. anticipates its full-year earnings per share being relatively flat, partly due to the higher cocoa and sugar costs. Hershey stock ended Friday down 3.4%. Pennsylvania lags only slightly behind national figures for the number of working-age adults who have earned college degrees or other professional certifications after high school. More details from Danielle Smith.
New data from Lumina Foundation tracks degree attainment, and the group's benchmark is that 60% of working-age adults should be earning some kind of post-high school degree by the year 2025. Right now, that number is over 53% in the Keystone State and just over 54% nationwide. Courtney Brown with the foundation says the research shows the nation is making steady progress towards the 60% goal.
We've moved from 38.1% when we began to 54.3%. That represents 16 percentage point increase in just 14 years. And that's, you know, a collective commitment and dedication to education from partners all across the country.
Brown added 42 states along with Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico saw an uptick in degree attainment last year. The increase was more than 1% in 19 states, including Pennsylvania.
Police say a woman in a trench coat opened fire with a long gun inside celebrity pastor Joel Osteen's Texas megachurch before being gunned down by two off-duty officers who confronted her. The afternoon shooting at the Houston megachurch sent worshipers scrambling out of the building between busy Sunday services. Authorities say the woman was dead and a 5-year-old boy with her was critically wounded by gunfire. They also say a 57-year-old man was wounded. Houston Police Chief Troy Finner praised the officers for their quick actions. Osteen says the shooting could have been much worse if it happened during the larger 11 a.m. service. Coming off a record-breaking week, Wall Street drifted towards modest losses early Monday with more corporate earnings on tap and another inflation update coming from the U.S. government. Futures for the S&P 500 were flat before the bell, while futures for the Dow Jones Industrial Average fell less than 0.1%. This week brings an important update from the Labor Department on consumer inflation. Corporate profits have mostly been better than expected for the big companies in the S&P 500 this reporting season, which is roughly two-thirds finished. Later this week, Shopify, DoorDash, and WK Kellogg report their most recent financial results.
Here's the Beaver County forecast.
Partly sunny today with a high near 50. A bit colder tonight, we may see a rain and snow mix in the early morning hours with a low of about 33. Partly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the low 40s. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
That's a look at news for now. I'm Matt Durzik for Beaver County Radio News, 99.3 FM, 1230 WBVP, and streaming live at beavercountyradio.com.
Where the listeners of Beaver County have a voice. Teleforum with Eddie Crow, 724-843-1888, 724-774-1888.
Well, here we are. We're down to the last segment of this program, and I feel absolutely wonderful. I hope you have enjoyed the messages that we have put across, the guest speakers that I've had on here today, and my message. If you'd like, here's my challenge for everybody. And I've used this a long time. I have a $1,000 challenge. If anything that I talk about in giving people advice, I am a licensed fiduciary. And if you don't believe it's right, you have an opportunity to challenge me. And if you win that challenge, it would give you a $1,000 reward for that challenge. But I would hopefully suggest that you wouldn't bring the advice from Billy Bob at work or Aunt Minnie, the dinner table at Thanksgiving, her discussion of finance and savings. Bring your calculator. Because everything that I talk about, do your research, you have to follow up, is absolutely spot on and provable mathematically. I challenge you, anybody that you've got a young family, you want to, here's a story. I have one family, been with me for 20 plus years. They're both husband and wife. They're both professionals, make a lot of income. When I met them, they had a lot of debt 20 years ago, school loans and everything. So right now, today, we only have a mortgage, but we've created seven figures of savings, and now the oldest son is off to college. And we used life insurance to accumulate capital to have it available and eliminated the federal government from their tax picture in all this money. So they borrowed from the insurance company against their policy to pay for the son's tuition. Well, the tuition, when the son graduates college, he's going to get a job. And I don't know whether he's going to be a doctor or whatever, but I'm sure professional. He's a smart kid. And then he's going to pay the loans back through mom and dad, through the family money farm, back into those policies, because he is guaranteed to receive a multi-million dollar death benefit at mom and dad's demise. So I don't know where you could put money in a 401k, a retirement plan of any kind, and have any kind of results that would come even close to receiving multi-million dollars in your 50s or 60s when mom and dad pass away, absolutely tax-free. But this takes planning. This is not get rich quick in any way, shape, or form. So you have to plan for it. So if you're a young family out there and you're working and you're doing well and you're trying to save some money and you want to create a plan, I challenge you to come sit with me for 45 minutes. I will make you two promises. Number one, I will not ask you to buy anything. There will not be any discussion of sales of any kind, etc. There won't be a second meeting unless you desire it. And the promise that I will make to you is I can assure you when you walk away from that meeting, you will know more about finances and how to accumulate wealth throughout your lifetime, more than any other way that you could learn this information, because basically it's not available on the marketplace. But again, my number is 724-728-6820. You can find me on the web at www.1stconsultantsinc.com. There's a calendar on the top of the webpage there. You can book a phone call, a Zoom meeting. I have clients in 38 states. Or a face-to-face meeting if you're in the local area in what's going on. If you want to get a free copy of my book and you don't want to send me your address and I will mail you an autographed copy, you can go to CFO-project.com. That is CFO, like a CFO of a company, hyphen, that's a dash, project.com. Put in your name and email address and you'll get an email with a link. In that email, you will be able to download my book, The Family Money Farm, The CFO Project, and my new book. It's an ebook called Financial Mastery Coaching, The Blueprint, as a bonus gift to you. So let's get back to our story of the Federal Reserve. And we were talking about the crash of 2000, 2001, and here we are. Now we're at 2008. And the meltdown has started. Now, why did it start? Well, let's go back to 1999, and Bill Clinton was president, and he told the banking industry, you will loan money to people over there on the other side of the tracks. These people aren't well known for being able to pay their bills. However, he told the banks, if you don't loan money to those people, we're going to call it discrimination, and we're going to come after you. So they started making loans to people that had no income. There was a million loans, mortgage loans made to illegal immigrants down in the D.C., Virginia area. And that was through Countrywide, which was the national company that would link the government to these loans, and the way it went on. But the big thing in the loans, if you ever got a mortgage, there's a lot of fees in a mortgage. These people made tons and tons and tons of money making these mortgages. Wasn't long before the banks figured out that they weren't real credible loans, that they were not going to be real creditworthy loans. So what the banks did is, smartly, they bundled them up and they sold them to Wall Street. Wall Street created investment products and told people, well, these are first mortgages. These are the best investments that you could invest in. But nobody ever disclosed that the borrowers in these loans weren't of the highest quality borrowers, and which led to lawsuits. I mean, there was a lot of things that went on. So Wall Street was actually sued over this because of the misinformation they provided to investors that invested in these loans. A company called AIG, which sells insurance, but their parent company is a stock brokerage firm. So these are fat cats from Wall Street. They looked at the situation and they said, we will insure those mortgage portfolios for Wall Street. And they were known as credit default swaps. Okay, so these were credit default swaps. They were instruments in the marketplace. They were bets is really what they were. They were gambling. So if a mortgage defaulted inside of a portfolio, AIG would take that mortgage and they would buy it out of the mortgage and replace it with cash. Then they created their own bundles of mortgages and resold them as mortgages. They were a little bit riskier and they sold them that way. But there was so much default, AIG went bankrupt to the tune of $85 billion. Now, here we are, folks. If you've ever lost any money in the stock market, in your 401k, lost money, investment portfolio, lost money, did anybody ever bail you out because of the dumb decisions that people made? No. Well, then why the heck did the government bail out AIG for the dumb, stupid decisions these fat cats made on Wall Street with yours and my tax money to the tune of $85 billion to bail out AIG because they said they were too big to fail? You know, folks, if you step back and you start to look at this stuff, you got to really, really question where you're getting your advice from. Because most of the advice that is out there that everybody receives, it's coming from the people that are doing all this stuff and have been doing it for years and years and years. So here we are down the road. It is 2023. We had COVID in 2020. We now know, fact, COVID came from a Wuhan lab in China. It was, they say, an accident. But the Wuhan lab was operated by the CCP. They took it over in 2019. Another fact. Now, I don't know about you folks, but I start seeing facts add up, and then I start to get a different picture altogether on what I'm reading and the vibrations I'm getting and so on. So here's where we're at. This virus that was released, accident, on purpose, I don't know. You know, we sit here and listen to the World Economic Forum and their discussion of depopulation. What the heck are they talking about? They're saying that the planet has too many people on it and the ideal number of people on the planet should be a billion. I don't know about you folks, but that's 600 billion people that got to disappear in some way. I don't know how they're going to do that. It gets scarier every day. In America right now, we have the most important election coming up. We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to finish out with a discussion on how do I protect me and mine and end up with some kind of real savings.
Here's the Beaver County Forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM. along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
A chilly start to the morning, otherwise partly sunny with a high near 50. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
Tune in to Beaver County Radio every Tuesday from 4 to 6 p.m. for the Sports Corner with Ralph Williams and Smokin' Jim Frazier. The Sports Corner talks about everything that is currently going on in the sports world. Ralph and Smokin' Jim will also have special guests every week, and they'll take your calls. The show will also be streamed live on the Beaver County Radio Facebook page and YouTube channel. So make plans every Tuesday at 4 p.m. to tune in to the Sports Corner right here on Beaver County Radio.
The views and opinions expressed on WBVP and WMBA are those of the participants and host. They are not necessarily the viewpoint of WBVP and WMBA, its staff, management, and advertisers. Thank you for listening to WBVP and WMBA.
Beaver County Transit Authority connects you to where you wanna be. The doctor's office for well-deserved shopping spree will take you to wherever you please. Safe, no fuss, leave the driving to us. Hop on, adventures coming your way. Beaver County Transit Authority, BCTA. Ride the bus.
With winter blues coming to an end, the Beaver County Transit Authority is excited to announce big changes are coming soon. We are reimagining and redefining how we connect Beaver County and can't wait to share it with you. Want to stay in the loop? Sign up for our email notifications at www.bcta.com or follow us on social media at RideBCTA. Stay tuned for more information.
The place for news, sports, and entertainment. You're listening to Beaver County Radio, 99.3 FM and 1230 WBVP, coming to you live from the all-new Fry Transportation Studios.
Here's the Beaver County forecast on 95.7 and 99.3 FM, along with 1230 WBVP, 1460 WMBA, and streaming at beavercountyradio.com.
A chilly start to the morning, otherwise partly sunny with a high near 50. I'm Lisa Marie with your local Beaver County weather.
Love is in the air, and Valentine's Day is just around the corner. Why fight the crowds by going out to dinner? Cook dinner at home and let the East Rochester and Tusca Shop and Save be your one-stop shop for you to spoil your Valentine. For starters, at the East Rochester and Tusca Shop and Save, you can get your sweetheart flowers for the table and beer or wine to sip on as you wait for the main course. They have surf and turf, as well as a variety of steaks, seafoods, and chicken, along with everything else that you need for that special meal. The bakery at East Rochester and Tusca Shop and Save has treats as sweet as your sweetheart, like heart-shaped mini cupcakes and chocolate chip cookies. They also have Valentine-themed cakes, cupcakes, and pastries of multiple varieties. Finish that up with that perfect greeting card, and you will be set for the perfect romantic evening at home. While at East Rochester Shop and Save, take a look at the True Value Hardware. They have everything you need for your next project. That's the East Rochester and Tusca Shop and Saves.
Hey, folks, we're back. We've rounded the corner here, and we've got about 10 to 15 minutes left, and I still got a whole bunch that I want to throw in here. But again, I challenge you, give me a chance, give me a call, make an appointment, call 724-728-6820. You can go to www.1stconsultantsinc.com, and right at the top of that webpage is my calendar. You can go into my calendar and book an appointment. There is no charge. There's no fee. I won't ask you to buy anything. And my personal mission in life is to help people realize the potential that lies inside each and every one of us. Our journey, we've talked about the Federal Reserve, and we talked about all these things today. There was a comment earlier that Kim made that I'm aware of, and the retirement age today is age 87. Let me quantify that a little bit and say, why is that the answer? Well, everybody I meet that is close to retirement, I tell them, you cannot disconnect from making money. You realize in the last 3 years, there's been 20%. So your dollars today, compared to 2019, are only worth 80 cents. So we lost 20% of purchasing power in the last 3 years. So that's sort of what we're talking about. Now, retirement age, in 1890, there was a guy in Germany named Bismarck. He was an economist, and he said that a German worker reaching age 65 should be able to retire and receive some kind of government stipends. Life expectancy was 49 years old. In 1933, President Roosevelt come along, and in order to buy jobs for the young people, he had to buy the older people, the chronologically gifted folks, out of their job, and that was where Social Security was originally created. Now realize, at that time, there were approximately 24 workers paying into the system for every one Social Security recipient. Today, there is only three. Now, in 1933, life expectancy was age 59. Today, life expectancy, if you're 65 years old today, your life expectancy, mister, is age 84. And missus, your life expectancy is age 86. If you're a fairly healthy couple at age 65, it's a 27% chance one of the two of you is going to be alive at age 97. Do you look at the obituaries in the newspaper or wherever you're looking and see how many 90-year-olds that are still alive in those papers and dying? And realize that age 84 for male and 86 for female is only the bell curve. You understand the bell curve. In other words, half of the people in that category have died by age 84 or 86, but half are still alive. So the reality of it is, how could you work for 30 years and expect to save enough money to be retired for 30 plus years and have enough money to do that? Unfortunately, it's part of the lie that we're being told about everything. They could have fixed the Social Security system years ago when they increased the age from 65 to 67, put some kind of mechanism in there that as longevity continues to increase, the plan would continue to increase as long as you have to work. They're not going to take Social Security away. This is going to happen. Eventually, they're going to be forced to make some changes to where people that are 40 today are not going to have the same Social Security retirement plan that a 65-year-old has today. They're not going to take anybody's Social Security away that's already at retirement. That leads me to my last little story of the day, and it's the billionaire lemmings effect. Now, what does that mean? Little George Lemming. Now, lemmings are little rodent-type animals, and they have no leadership in their organization, and they live in clusters. I'll call it the Lemmings Town. And little George Lemming lived on the east side of town, and his goal that day, he said, this is it. I'm going to end it. I'm going to take my life today. I'm going to run through town, and over on the west side of town, there is a cliff that goes down 400 feet to the rocks in the ocean, and I'm going to run as fast as I can through town, straight out the other side and right off of that cliff, and I'm going to end it all today. So little George Lemming, he gets up and he's out the door and he's running as fast as he can go. And as he approaches town, he's going to run right through the middle of town. Well, all the other lemmings are watching George. Hey, George, where are you going? Where are you going, George? Where are you going? And so everybody in town files out and starts running as fast as they can, following little George out to the edge of the cliff. How many of them do you think got stopped before they got pushed over the cliff? The billionaires of the world, the World Economic Forum, all of these people that think they know more than we do, the Club of Rome, their new thing, believe me, they created the crisis of climate change. I keep reading articles and information from people that are degreed. They're climatologists, they're people, and there is no climate problem. In 10 years, the ocean didn't rise. If you're buying property on the coastline in Florida, and this is really going to happen and the oceans are going to rise 10 feet, why are the banks still loaning mortgages on those properties that are beachfront properties? Think about it, folks. You're being led down a manhole that there may not be no way back out of, and it's all about somebody making money. You know, can't think of his name, the vice president, and I'll think of it in a minute, it'll come to my mind. And he's been the guy that's been on top of this climate change. He graduated and was a vice president, and when he was out of office, he was broke. And now he's a multi-millionaire because of these climate change ideas that they have promoted with everybody and going on. So we have to wake up, folks. We have to stand up for ourselves. We have to start listening and starting to make judgments. I'm not here to tell you how to think today. That's not what I do. I just challenge you to think. I want you to start thinking of both sides. We have lost the ability in America to debate. Our politicians are fighting against other. There's no more debate for the best of the people anymore. It's all about, I got to get reelected. What can I do? What can I give away to the population so that they like me and they'll re-vote me and reelect me back into my position? We need term limits in this country. And we need to turn out some of these people that have been there for 20, 30, 40 years, and they're already as old as Methuselah. And now I say that in vain because if we don't get DJ Trump in November reelected, I don't believe there's any hope to salvage America. Now, you may not like me because I said that, and I really don't give a rat's butt. It's what I see. It's what I look at. This man, what he did in the 4 years he was there, we had more prosperity, more unemployment, more betterment, no inflation. We had more of everything in his ability to lead this country. We were honored by around the world. We had a presence and a fear among our enemies, and there were no wars and none of this crap going on now was happening. You need, I'm praying, folks, this is godly. This is the only way. If this doesn't happen in November, and my fear is that they somehow will try to assassinate him, if their lawsuits don't work and everything that they're doing, these folks are so desperate. That's all I got to say. We're coming to the end of the day. I thank you for listening today. I hope and pray you'll tell people about me. I just want to make your life better. God bless you all.
You're listening to 99.3 FM, presented by St. Barnabas, in addition to 1230 WBVP Beaver Falls.
The Lenten season has arrived, and besides celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ,